The future of humanity, as Frederick Engels said, is either socialism or barbarism. Well, that's the choice in front of us. And I think that's nowhere is it more clear than the situation in the Middle East. The atrocities that we see every single day are literally nauseating. And the barbarism, which is raising its head, is, it's surprising for anyone. Now the bourgeois, they like to portray this every single day. We see it on the TV, in the news, in the papers. They cry crocodile tears. But the fact is that they are completely responsible for everything that's happening in the world. At every stage, at every step, they are responsible for this. In order to defend the narrow interests of a tiny elite, they're willing to drag the whole, the whole of civilization in the region down. And then they try to justify it. They theorize. Oh, Arabs want strong men. ISIS is just a bunch of men with really good military capabilities. Or if they want to go a little bit deeper, they say ISIS is a direct result of the Arab Revolution. Now, in all of these ideas is implicit the idea that the Arab masses, the Middle Eastern masses, are backward, a low level of consciousness, unlike us nice developed Europeans. They don't want or they're unable to understand democracy, and they don't want it. But rather live in a tribal medieval society. Now that's obviously a very superficial way of looking at things. At best, it's completely one-sided. But it's only a way for them to, sweep away their own crimes, really. Because the history of the Middle East is the history of imperialist oppression, of wars, of murder. And in order to get access to resources and trade routes, the imperialists, starting from the British and then the Americans, have been willing to subjugate a whole people and push them in, confine them to a life of deprivation, of poverty, and most importantly, a situation with no future. The majority of the Arab population is youth. Vast majority. 40% of this youth is unemployed. And there's a whole layer of society which has nothing to look forward to. If you go to the Middle East, this is a very typical day for a young Middle Eastern person. You wake up. You have a cigarette and a cup of tea. That's your breakfast. And you go to the coffee shop. Then you go to the next coffee shop. And then the next one. And then you go home. It's not because it's fun. Because there's nothing to do. There's nothing to develop. And this lays the foundation for the developments that we've seen. And the first reaction to this was the Arab Revolution. Now the bourgeois are quick to forget this event. You see, the Arab masses did not just revolt once. They rebelled many times. In Tunisia, there's been at least two uprisings. In Egypt, two revolutions. But five heads of state have been overthrown. 17 million people came out against Mohamed Morsi. And within only a few days, the Arab masses overthrew these heads of state. Monstrous dictatorships, enormous state apparatuses, were just swept aside by the force of the mass movement. There was a developing general strike in Egypt. There were councils in every neighborhood, organization committees. The soldiers were not fraternizing with the masses. The police was fraternizing with the masses. Power was in the hands of the population. Power was in the hands of the people. And the bourgeois could only look. Now the problem is this. The revolution, we have to say honestly, was not prepared for this. And in Egypt, they handed power back to another faction of the ruling class. They did this several times. And the same as Tunisia. Now, we've talked about the Arab revolutions lots of times. There's no need to explain everything. But it's enough to say that the masses could have taken power many, many, many times. If they had had the program and the plan and the revolutionary leadership to do so. But the thing is this, if you don't take power, then everything is not just going to go back to the way it was before. And that's not how revolutions work. You create a vacuum of power on the one hand, which allows the counter-revolution to maneuver. But you also radicalize the counter-revolution. The ruling class is radicalized. So this is a different ruling class which is going to strike back. Now, another element is this. You cannot be on the streets forever. In Egypt, the masses were on the streets for 4 years. one uprising after the other, overthrowing one head of state after the other. But now there is a sense of tiredness. There's a sense that, well, we've never been defeated. That's a very important factor. The Egyptian revolution has never been defeated. But there is a question, why do we keep doing this and when the result is the same? And therefore you have an ebb in the movement. And you have a period of reaction. Now in Syria and Libya, these were the weakest links of the Arab Revolution. The Ba'athist regime in Syria was built on a planned economy. Although Assad was beginning to open up and privatize and move closer to the West. Especially in the eastern parts of the country where the revolution actually started. But Syria stood out from the rest of the Middle East. There was low unemployment, cultural level was high, education was free, there was people had a stable life. And when they looked around, they saw Iraq, they saw Lebanon. So they were skeptical about what this country could end up with moving towards. Especially because the Syrian revolutionaries were not calling for workers' control, for higher wages, or better living conditions. They're calling for democracy, which we support, of course. But they were calling for American intervention to do this. They thought, well, Assad, well, in Libya, they overthrew Gaddafi with the help of U.S. imperialism. So why don't we do it? And they moved the whole movement towards an armed struggle. You see, for Syrian workers, well, democracy and U.S. imperialism. We've heard about this before. In Iraq, it had absolutely no force of attraction. And that's why, in fact, during the Syrian revolution, at least I didn't hear, but I couldn't find any news about any strike of the working class. That's the difference between Egypt and Syria. But the workers didn't move. Now, there were already Islamists in Syria from before the revolution. Assad kept them there to use them inside Iraq, to have influence inside Iraq. But once the revolution started, these groups became an interesting factor for the imperialists. You had Turkey, the Gulf states, Saudi Arabia, Jordan. Pouring billions of dollars into these groups. Uh, and hijacking the movement and pushing it towards an Islamist movement, basically. This is, they might have not built ISIS directly, but by whipping up this sectarianism, pushing the country towards a civil war, supporting this faction of Al-Qaeda, that faction of Al-Qaeda. They built the movement which led, for which ISIS was the natural consequence. Of course, they didn't care about anything about democracy or the rights of the Syrian people. For the imperialists, the war in Syria played two roles. One, to cut across the Arab Revolution. And secondly, to strike blows against Iran. The Americans and the Saudis thought this is a quick victory. They built up these radical Islamist groups. You know, in the West, they would portray them as freedom fighters. As long as they were only decapitating Syrians. There's even recently a CIA document was leaked. We spoke about the interesting perspective of building an Islamist principality in eastern Syria. With Al-Qaeda in Iraq, which was the predecessor of ISIS, as one of the main forces to build this. This shows the extreme short-sightedness of these people as well. Because sectarianism strengthened Assad. It pushed the Syrian population behind him. I don't think anyone has any illusions in Assad being a dictator and the fact that his interests are not the same as the Syrian people's. But the Syrian masses would 1,000 times rather have the stability of an Assad dictatorship than the barbarism that the Americans and the Gulf states were offering. You know, someone said, one of the bourgeois said, everyone who's tried to tame the Islamists have been bitten by them. The Americans have built up the Islamists for 50 years. They still haven't learned, though. They still haven't learned. In Pakistan, they're basically undermining the whole basis of the nation. And today they're coming back to ravage the whole of the Middle East. And the same thing happened in Iraq. There was no, this small principality was not confined to Syria, but use the arms and billions which was being poured into the Syrian civil war to attack inside Iraq. And suddenly, they were barbarians. Within 24 hours. As if they came out of nowhere. Now this also changed the whole dynamic of the war, in fact. It became a threat to American interests. They tried, right before that, they tried to strengthen the, to accelerate the downfall of Assad by intervening, by bombing. But they could not pull it through politically inside the US and Europe. So they had to pivot back. They were afraid that that Syria was going to become a new Iraq, a failed state, which would destabilize the whole region. And within a few weeks, they turned back, and de facto, the closest ally became the Assad regime and the Iranians. Of course, for their allies, the Saudis, the Turks, the Gulf states, this was not feasible. They only went in to overthrow Assad. They made so many investments. And suddenly the Americans want to give up those investments and fight against them. And this has created serious tensions between the US imperialism and its allies in the region. Now, this is a major factor in the conflict in the Middle East. See, after the collapse of the Soviet Union, US imperialism was the only superpower in the world. And the American bourgeoisie was overconfident. They attacked Afghanistan, they attacked Iraq, thinking that they could just do whatever they want. But they were defeated in those countries. They never carried out any of the goals they set themselves. And they had to withdraw not only with a military defeat, but an economic defeat, a debt of trillions of dollars. And most importantly, a political defeat with mass opposition developing in the country against war. And the only way they could pull out of Iraq was to lean on the Iranians, which until then had been part of the axis of evil. Of course, this was a threat to their own allies, the Saudis. I'll get back to why in a minute. But Iran was massively strengthened after the Iraq War. Because the Americans not only overthrew Saddam Hussein, but they also destroyed his state apparatus and his army, which meant that there was nothing to hold the Iranian army in check. Now, with the rise of ISIS, this position was strengthened. And Iran is de facto the most important ally of the US in the Middle East. You know, some people say, well, no, the Americans could do whatever they want. But that's the whole problem, they can't. In the Middle East, the US imperialism has shown its limits, its limitations. It's proven that it's reached a period of decline. which is a part of the world crisis of capitalism. It's a deep economic crisis, a debt crisis within the US. The political system is completely paralyzed. The military is demoralized and completely rotten. And more importantly than anything else, is mass opposition to any kind of major imperialist adventure. This limits the power of US imperialism in the world. It cannot intervene as it used to. which means that in the Middle East is dependent on Iran. And you might have followed the nuclear negotiations. There's lots of technical mumbo jumbo, as I would say, which is designed for people not to understand it. Because the deal is exactly this. In return for giving the Iranians access to the world markets, and for the Iranian bourgeoisie to become a part of the establishment of the international community, they are offering the services to U.S. imperialism of stabilizing the Middle East, of trying to. No one else can play this role in the Middle East. But at the same time, this is causing severe fractions within the alliances that the U.S. Traditionally has in the region. Over the past year, there's been an accelerating campaign by Benjamin Netanyahu, the Prime Minister of Israel, against the U.S. administration. In return, the Americans supported the Israeli opposition against Netanyahu during the elections. Saudi Arabia and Turkey are openly supporting all kinds of Al-Qaeda factions in the region. In Turkey's case, they're working openly with ISIS. At the same time as officially being in the coalition against ISIS. In Yemen, in March, Saudi Arabia started a barbaric war against Yemen. Especially against the Houthis. But this was against American imperialism, and they weren't even told about this attack. Because they were the best fighters and the best allies of the U.S. in the fight against Al-Qaeda in the Arab Peninsula. Likewise, a few days ago, last week, Turkey started a war against the PKK. And the Kurds in Syria, Iraq, and in Turkey. Now, the Americans, we should have no illusions in that they want to help the PKK or the Kurds. To achieve any kind of statehood, independence, or anything like that. Yeah. But they want to use them at this moment because they're the most efficient fighters against ISIS. So they've been out every day, almost every day, with the contradicting statements. Whether we're gonna set up a safety zone inside Syria, that's what the Turks said, and then the Americans said, oh, there's no safety zone in Syria. And so he said, oh, the NATO is behind us, and then the Americans said, well, we need to be careful of what we're doing. It's clear that there is a split, which is caused by the crisis of U.S. imperialism. And this crisis is causing instability, and is creating room for smaller powers to maneuver. At the same time, the smaller powers are propelled by the crisis of capitalism and its effect inside their own countries. To act, to intervene in the region. This is an unsolvable contradiction in the present setup. Something has to give. And this means that in the foreseeable future, at least until the medium term and even probably also long term, instability is only going to rise in the Middle East. Now in Iraq, you know, the Americans talk about the barbarians of ISIS. How many people do you think ISIS have killed? Any one of you, give a guess. 50,000? 400,000. Do you think ISIS has killed? 400,000. That's 400. Let's say they killed 50. Let's say they killed 100,000 people. The U.S. occupation of Iraq killed more than 1 million people, and that's a conservative estimate. Five million people were displaced. The infrastructure was completely destroyed. Poverty is on the rise. Unemployment is extremely high. There's no water. Access to water is a luxury. Access to electricity. 22% of children in Iraq has had their growth stunted because of malnutrition. And there is a lumpenization of the youth who have nothing to do, have nothing, no productive activity to engage in. Now, they destroyed the social equilibrium of the country. They destroyed the state apparatus. And then they built a new one, completely, entirely based on sectarianism. Every state institution has sectarianism embedded in it. You know, the president is a Kurd, always. The prime minister is a Shia. And the speaker of parliament is a Sunni. And then they wonder where all the sectarianism is coming from.
about?
They put in a prime minister, Nouri al-Maliki, who's literally a gangster. My personal theory is they put in there because he was the most corrupt person they could find. There was a compromise with the Iranians. So whoever could pay him the most could decide. He had death squads. He imprisoned political opponents, journalists, activists, sabotaged every single non-sectarian movement that tried to that the Iraqi population tried to build. Even bourgeois liberal ones. He did extortion, assassinations. And all of this he did while the US occupation was still taking place. Now, this was the situation before the Arab Revolution. And we didn't hear much about this, and unfortunately we didn't write enough about this. But the Arab Revolution did have an echo inside Iraq. There was a national democratic movement immediately after the revolution in Egypt. It was based on the demands for jobs, democracy, against corruption. No sign of sectarianism. It was mainly based in the western, northwestern Sunni areas. But it was also, it had big support in the Shia areas as well. So how did these democratic representatives of US imperialism act with this movement? With barbarism, with brutality, imprisoning thousands, killing thousands. In Fallujah, just before, at the end of 2013, and Ramadi, there's a huge movement of youth taking over the streets and the squares, camping for months. It was clear that the Saudis were trying to maneuver to get an influence in this movement. They were paying off the tribes. Their Islamist henchmen were circling the movement. But I saw an interview with one of the young kids. He said, "We have nothing to do with any of these people. Any of the politicians. We're against all of them. We want democracy and we want social justice." Which was the main demands of the Arab Revolution. What did Maliki do? He started bombing the whole city. Barrel bombing the whole city. And this radicalized the movement. This pushed it into an armed struggle. And of course, the forces which were there had the most money, of course, were strengthened. You had basically a collapse of state authority, of state legitimacy in the whole Anbar province. Yeah. And a similar process started developing in Mosul, in the north. Now the Iraqi army had 30,000 people there. But who were these people? A big part of them were Sunnis, who felt victimized, justly felt victimized by the sectarian policies of al-Maliki. A large part of those actually, a significant part of those were Islamists, were drifting towards Islamism. Then there were the Kurds, Peshmerga forces from northern Iraq, who didn't have any, loyalty towards the Iraqi state. Also because of Maliki's policies. And then there were the Shias. They didn't feel that Maliki was their president either. Who were they fighting for? They were hungry, under-equipped, humiliated. So this is the situation where ISIS moved in. And another thing, you know, about the Kurds of Iraq. You know, in Western media, they're portrayed as these good Democrats. This is what we want all of Iraq to be like. But Barzani, President of the Kurdish region, is an absolute reactionary. He's a tribal warlord. He has serious dictatorial tendencies. And it's quite clear that there was some kind of an understanding between ISIS and the Peshmerga when they moved in. Because they pulled out their forces and immediately started going after Kirkuk, which is a town they've always wanted. And they started grabbing areas which were not traditionally Kurdish or which were contested. So you see, it's all, as Alan said yesterday, it's a bunch of bandits, smaller and bigger bandits, robbing each other. Now, in this situation, the only forces that came out as capable of actually shoring up ISIS were the Shia militias, which were built by a call from one of the important Shia clerics. To mobilize and fight against ISIS. But the fact that they were built on sectarian bases as well. It's just reinforcing the same process of disintegration that's been taking place. Now, in this whole thing, Saudi Arabia has been very dissatisfied, let's say, with the actions of the Americans. There's been serious tension. Because the Iraq war left Saudi Arabia extremely weak. You see, with the Iraqi army gone, There's very little distance between Iran and Saudi Arabia. Which from a military standpoint is a major threat. And it means that they cannot continue doing what they want to do as they used to in the Middle East. There's another point of contention between the US and the Saudis. Of course, the fact that the US are cooperating with the Iranians does not make this better. But the fact that the Saudis, but the fact that the Americans did not intervene in the Arab Revolution, to shore up to defend Mubarak basically in Egypt, which they could never do in any case, also created friction between the Americans and the Saudis. Now, with the present nuclear deal that's been made, their relationship is at a low ebb. And Saudi Arabia's position in the region and the world is in danger, in fact. The US used to buy all its oil, almost all its oil from the Saudis. But last year, the Americans at one point were the biggest oil-producing country of the world. Now, this not only is a threat to the relationship between the Saudis and the Americans, but also to the position of Saudi Arabia in the world in general. And in fact, since last war, Saudi Arabia started a price war on oil, aimed at crushing the US oil boom. And also aimed at undermining the Iranian regime. At the same time, the Saudi clients or traditional allies are weak. They went to war in Yemen, counting on all the Arab states. They made very grandiose resolutions. But when it came to sending actual troops, they all backed out one after another. Egypt, Pakistan, Turkey, and they were left with themselves. And this exposed them militarily also. This humiliated them. But you see, there was a very interesting interview with Obama a few months ago in New York Times. And he said, well, we're going to defend the Saudis against external threats, no matter what. But the main problem is internal. You see, the Saudi regime is sitting on a sea of wealth. But it has no legitimacy whatsoever. The previous king's daughter, one of his many, many, many daughters, got married. And he bought her a golden toilet. You should look for golden toilet on Google. See the pictures. And next to it, there's this princess. There's a picture of the princess in a golden dress. It's almost like a statue, and she's sticking her head out of it. It's disgusting. And all the while, there's mass poverty in Saudi Arabia, something we never hear about. Four million out of the 18 million Saudis are poor, live in poverty. Now, the state ideology of Saudi Arabia, every regime needs to justify its rule. But the Saudis do the exact opposite. The state ideology is Wahhabism, which is the basis of all the Islamist groups that you see. But they don't believe in having a king. They want a caliph. So this is what started in the throughout the education system in Saudi Arabia. It's an ideology which is incompatible with the kingdom itself. But the Saudi kings long time, the Saudi tribes long time ago made a deal with the Wahhabis. Saying that if you allow us to have power, we'll give you the education system and the foreign policy, all this. You can have all that. Give you billions of dollars to build schools and institutions throughout the region, which is how the Al Qaeda, Taliban, all these groups actually arose. But the point is also, the stronger these groups get, the more they want to target the Saudis. And there's a wide layer within Saudi Arabia which is very sympathetic to these ideas. And want to overthrow the kingdom. At the same time, there is a significant Shia minority which is massively oppressed. And in fact, in the schools, they're taught that they're not real Muslims. I.e. that they don't deserve to live. In second grade, third grade. And at the same time, there's also tribal forces in Saudi Arabia. And as I said, class differentiation. Class contradiction, sorry. And there's a rebellion amongst the youth who see no future in this barbaric regime. Who feel suffocated. Again, in Saudi Arabia, the Arab Revolution had an echo. There were youth protests, there were several strikes. Most importantly, there was a big movement in the northeastern areas, in the Shia population. Which led to the situation that in a whole swath of this area, the state can no longer operate. Police is no longer allowed. And they've set up self-defense committees to run society, basically. So you see, the Saudi nation is a weak nation. is stretched between all kinds of completely opposing forces. Which means that the Saudi army is an extremely weak army. I think it's the fourth most expensive army in the world. But they've never been to war. Because they wouldn't be able to win. They'll probably disintegrate. And every time they've gone to war, they've hired the Pakistani army to do their war for them. Now the old king was an extremely reactionary, barbaric king, like all of them. But he had a little bit of something up there. He realized that any movement in any direction could break up the whole country. And so he was very conservative in everything he did. Didn't want too much movement or too many things happening. He feared populism, he feared revolution. But the new king who came just in January and his son, they seem to be completely detached from the real world. Like playing a computer game. Like playing Risk. Oh, let's start a war in Yemen. And that's exactly what they did. Just to say, in Yemen there was a revolution in 2012 which overthrew the oldest Abdullah Saleh dictatorship. But again, because of the lack of a leadership, he was replaced by another Saudi puppet, Mansour Hadi. And if you read the bourgeois media today, that is the legitimate president of Yemen. But they forget to tell one little detail. His term ended last year, in February. And he just didn't organize new elections. And the Hadi regime was probably even more corrupt than the previous Saleh one. Because Saleh understood the tribal landscape of Yemen. Saleh, the previous thing, he understood the tribal landscape of Yemen. And he gave a little to everyone. But Hadi wanted everything for himself and his close allies. So there was mass opposition developing to the Hadi regime. Now, in this situation, the Houthis, who are actually a tribal force, it's not a religious force, as they say. They developed a populist attitude towards the movement. Advised by Iran and Hezbollah. Although they're not direct proxies for Iran. And they waged a campaign against corruption, against unemployment, against inflation. And the Hadi government collapsed, in fact. Now, I don't have time to go into the whole situation. But this was a major threat to Saudi Arabia. It was a country which was supposed to be its country. Which was now being ruled by groups which were sympathetic to Iran. And it was also a populist movement, which is a very major threat to Saudi Arabia. Any kind of populist movement is whether reactionary or progressive. And at the same time, they made the choice of appeasing the jihadists back home. And they've been bombing Yemen now for 4 months in a barbaric siege, really, of the whole country. It's the poorest country in the Middle East. It has one of the smallest water reserves of the Middle East. And life is just for survival to the Yemeni. More than 500,000 people have been displaced internally. The whole infrastructure is destroyed. Of course, with the kind assistance of US imperialism, the wars, the planes, the weapons, the planes, the bombs. And then they wonder why there's so many refugees in Europe. But this situation shows the complete short-sightedness of the bourgeoisie and their degeneracy at this stage. Because this had a major backlash throughout the region. Egypt, with Al-Sisi, President Sisi, who was out saying, "We are behind our Saudi brothers, anything it takes, forward." He had to back out. Because there was mass opposition to sending land troops inside Egypt. In fact, one commentator said that he's not seen a similar situation since the 2013 revolution. The Pakistani army had to withdraw because it's a Shia Sunni army. So now they want to send Muslims to fight not Muslims. They thought they were just going to fight the Indians. And it could have led to the collapse of the Pakistani army, in fact. And a similar situation is developing in Turkey. Although also Erdogan wants to be friends with everyone because he's trading with the Iranians as well. But this also had a major backlash inside Saudi Arabia itself. Because ISIS made several terrorist attacks against Shias in Saudi Arabia. To whip up sectarianism against Shias. But this led to a massive movement inside the Shia areas. Huge movement. Some people say up to 1 million people on the streets in an area of 2 million people. Yes. There was the self-defense committees inside Saudi Arabia were widened, strengthened. Because everyone blamed the state. And the slogans in these demonstrations were against the Saudi state. Because everyone knows that they are responsible for ISIS. They are responsible for sectarianism, Wahhabism. And it was a class-based movement, in fact. And it also got an echo in the Sunni areas. Especially young people who were tired of this foreign policy of the Saudis. There's no way they can win the war in Yemen. You see, they're just bombing. They're not sending the troops because they know what's going to happen. No one, no foreign power in this century has won a war in Yemen. They've all been defeated. Nasser was defeated in the 60s. And the Saudis will be defeated one way or another. And this will lead to raise tensions and extreme instability inside Saudi Arabia. And personally, it's my personal opinion, I don't think Saudi Arabia will continue to exist many years to come. And this will add to the instability in the region. Now, in Turkey, you had 12 years of Erdogan regime, which was stabilized by the world economic upswing. Generally, unemployment fell. And there was a certain stability in people's lives. But at the same time, there was extreme inequality in Turkey. It's the second most unequal country in the OECD. The 10% richest people in Turkey own more than 77% of the wealth. And if you look at Istanbul, you see these areas where people live in obscene wealth, luxury. Right next to growing shanty towns. Now, the economic crisis brought these tensions to the surface again. And there's been a rising tide of opposition. Not only on the economic questions, but also against Erdogan's Ottomanization of Turkey, if you might call it. The Turkish people are secular people. But he's bringing an Islamization of society. And he's got very big imperialist plans of rebuilding the Ottoman Empire. And he's been trying in Tunisia, in Egypt, in Iraq. And he's in fact failed every single time. Which adds to his problems. And in Syria, from the beginning, he's had serious imperialist designs. He's been wanting to... With the Syrian revolution and the civil war, he saw an opportunity to grab a bite, basically. He's been supporting ISIS as a way of destabilizing the country. This is not a tacit support, it's not an inactive support. Well, especially against the Kurds, he's been using them as shock troops, basically. Just yesterday, they sent in Jabhat al-Nusra, which is the official al-Qaeda branch, from inside Turkey to attack Afrin, which is a Kurdish area in western Syria. And there's mass opposition to his foreign policies. And everyone can see that in order for Erdogan's personal greed, basically, and lust for power, he's willing to let these animals in, building vast networks, embedding themselves into society, and especially into the ruling class, different factions of it. And they're going to destabilize Turkey in the long run. He's also a thug. He's like a street thug. He has that mentality. And I don't know if you saw in what's the town called? I forgot the name. There's a mining accident in Soma. 1 year ago. There's mining accident caused by privatization, by cronyism, directly, completely linked to it. Lack of security. Actually a mine owned by a friend of Erdogan, a crony of Erdogan. Hundreds of people were killed. And then when the mourners went out on the streets, the state attacked them. And Erdogan attacked them. And there's a video image of him hitting, slapping a mourning woman inside a shopping cart. Now this actually does have an impact on the class struggle in bringing out the contradictions. But I think it's also a direct reflection of the parasitic nature of the Turkish bourgeoisie. Now in 2013 there was a Gezi Park movement, hundreds of thousands of people taken to the streets. This was the first warning of things beginning to develop in Turkey. But it had no leadership. And it fizzled out, basically. But in the elections in June, those contradictions came to the fore again. And you saw the first electoral defeat of Erdogan, who lost his majority. And you saw the rise of the HCP, who got 13%. Major blow to Erdogan. It was a massive victory for the Kurdish people and the radicalized youth of Turkey. Now this was the first time that the Kurdish nationalist movement took a correct position of appealing for alliance with the Turkish work, between the Kurdish and the Turkish working class. Which was an extremely positive step forward. And they did it on a radical program. And on the basis of unifying the extremely fragmented Turkish left. And this struck a chord with the layer of the youth. Now, this was a major blow to Erdogan because he lost his majority and cannot really rule. He thought they wouldn't get above the 10% threshold, which meant that all the votes would go to him. But he made a mistake. And he was willing, I'm sure that he was contemplating rigging the elections. But on the day of the elections, tens of thousands of young people surrounded all the voting booths, voting stations, and they were mobilized, they were ready. So he could have risked an uprising if he had done it. Now, for the past 2 months, the parliament has been paralyzed because they can't form a government. And clearly, Erdogan is not willing to share power with anyone in any case. So last week, when there was a terrorist attack in the town of Suruç, or province of Suruç, now let me just explain, this town is right next to the border with Kobani. No one can come in and out of this province without the Turkish intelligence and military checking them out. Hundreds of young leftist people were gathered to go to help rebuild Kobani. So, and I have no doubt, there's no doubt that the Turkish state had a role in this massacre. Like they've had several times in the past period of using ISIS and other Islamist groups to attack the Kurds, especially the Kurds in Syria. But he used this to provoke, he said, well, this means we have to join the war on ISIS. One tiny problem though. He's not attacking ISIS at all. He's attacking people who are fighting ISIS. He's bombing PKK positions, YPG positions in Syria. It's a sister organization of the PKK. And all the bombs that's going into ISIS territory are falling in the middle of nowhere, really, not killing anyone. Out of 1,000 people that, out of more than, way more than 1,000 people that he's arrested by now, less than 20% are ISIS. The majority are leftists, PKK, Kurdish activists, Turkish activists. And he's trying to whip up nationalism to strike blows against the Kurds and the left, especially the HDP. Especially the Kurds in Syria. Because after the Syrian civil war started, Assad pulled out his troops from the northeastern areas, the Kurdish areas. And he gave them autonomy, really. Because he couldn't fight that many fronts. And this means that the PYD, which is the sister organization of PKK, assumed power in these areas, de facto. And they were based on highly democratic structures. Democratic structures. Non-sectarian structures. In every area they took, they would build councils with every nationality, every people. And their fighters, and the People's Protection Units, their militia, has become a highly effective force because of this situation. Now, they're not receiving arms from anyone because no nation in the region wants to give the person idea that they can actually become independent. They don't have much money. They don't have much money. Sorry. But they do have the political advantage in every area that they fight. People welcome them because they bring peace and stability and democracy. a people's rule, you can say. And the fighters are convinced of what they're fighting for. You see, I mean, they're not Marxists. Some of them would say they are. But they fight against capitalism, against imperialism, and they fight for a better world. Which means that they'll fight to the end. It's the only force besides ISIS which is actually doing these things. Which is fighting like this. And they're fighting better than ISIS. Which has meant that they become quite important for US imperialism. You see, the imperialism, the imperialists might be not too happy with the leftist leanings of these groups. But they look at what's there on the ground. What's the most effective group? And they use them. It doesn't mean they're ever gonna give them autonomy, independence. But they're saying to the Turks, let's fight this war, let's finish this war. Let's stabilize Syria. And then we'll have a look at the Kurds. But the Kurds are getting influence inside Turkey. And it's a threat to Erdogan's personal position. So you can't allow that. Now, when Turkey announced the war on PKK, I mean, this is a NATO ally. This is a NATO ally for the Americans. And they backed them. They said, yes, Turkey has a right to defend itself against terrorism. Of course, it's completely hypocritical because Turkey is the biggest funder of terrorism in the whole world. But this is a lesson. It should be a lesson. For small nations, not Turkish, there's 40 million Kurds, but it's a minor nation in the grand scheme of things. They cannot depend on what the imperialists will give them, or what the bourgeoisie will give them. For the bourgeois, these peoples are mainly the small change in their negotiations. Okay, you get the Kurds, we get Syria. A tiny part of Syria. This is how it works. The only way they can actually win this war is by waging a revolutionary all regional struggle based on class basis. Now Erdogan now is holding the whole country hostages. He's saying, I'm fighting the terrorists, that's ISIS and PKK. And so that's why, so he's saying, well, if you want to get rid of ISIS, you have to deal with the PKK war as well. He's moving towards an open dictatorship. He's whipping up nationalism. He's trying to, in fact, illegalize the HDP. But he could cause a mass revolt. Because he's not a very popular person. And in this situation, with rising class struggle, the Turkish workers are on the struggles are on the rise. There could be a major backlash, and the imperialists are realizing this. So they're also developing there's also divisions developing in that relationship. Now, then we come to Iran. You see, the Iraq war, as I explained, left Iran as the major power in the region. And the rise of ISIS built on that, or strengthened that position. And this was the main reasons behind the nuclear deal which was made. But nevertheless, this was a major victory for against U.S. imperialism. It defeated U.S. imperialism. Because for 40 years they've been attacking Iran in every conceivable way. Economic war, actual war when they pushed Saddam to attack Iran. They encircled them by going to war in Afghanistan and Iraq. That was a warning to Iran, which was why they built the nuclear. They started building a nuclear bomb. After the deal was struck, some people compared the foreign minister of Iran with the prime minister in the 50s, Mossadegh. Who stood up against U.S. imperialism and British imperialism. And nationalized the Anglo-Iranian oil company, British Petroleum. And there is an element of truth in this comparison. Nevertheless, the Iranian regime is a bourgeois regime. This deal is not for the benefit of the working masses. Although they have defeated a warring and aggressive imperialist plan. But the regime is, I always compare it with the Bazaari regime, like a merchant regime. You know, you go to a bazaar, this type of person. You know, they can whip up a big hoo-ha. Death to America. Well, of course, they've been working with them in Afghanistan and Iraq. And they can shout and scream. But at the end of the day, all they want is a deal. They're willing to do the dirty work of U.S. imperialism, but they're not going to do it for free. Now, the Iranian people have been in an extreme tense position. It's like they've been holding their breaths. The barbaric sanctions which were imposed on Iran caused extreme inflation, at some point up to 100%. Lack of medicine, lack of spare parts for airplanes. Unemployment rose dramatically. The middle class was probably relatively seen as the biggest hit part of the society. Because its living standards collapsed. The middle class collapsed into the working class. And there was a threat of war. Constant threat of war. And for the Iranian working class, their wages did not rise. In fact, it was decreased every single year. Hundreds of thousands of workers were not paid by the bosses because the factories couldn't sell what they produced. So this was the first time that they could breathe. see light at the end of the tunnel. And this will strengthen the regime for temporarily, for a short period. They won over the Americans. And they're seen as the most progressive force in the region. If you look at the forces in the region, it's not far from the truth. But this doesn't mean that the contradictions are over in Iran. On the contrary, the present president came to power on a mass movement. Tens of thousands of people came to the streets in the days before his election. And they weren't calling for a nuclear deal, in fact. Some of them were. They were calling for political freedoms, social freedoms. And Rouhani said that just like our, turbines? Just like the centrifuges turn, so shall the lives of the people of Iran. That was what he came to power. Of course, for 2 years he's been able to say there are sanctions, you know, we can't do much. But now people are going to say, okay, now the sanctions are gone. Now we can solve our problems. The legitimacy of the regime is extremely low. The vast majority of the population were born after the revolution, have no attachment to the revolution. And for them, the Islamic Republic is, I mean, the mullahs and so on, it's not the pious ideals of that they promoted themselves on when they came to power. Because they're completely embedded in every single scandal and corruption, crimes, supporting all kinds of reactionary elements in the region. Besides, and they're seen as hypocrites, not taken seriously. At the same time, the supporters of the region, the regime, sorry. What was one of the main pillars? The threat of U.S. imperialism. It's gone now. You know, there was a CNN reporter who was driving a taxi in Iran about a year ago. And he asked the driver, "So, have you heard the Rouhani and Obama have spoken on the phone?" It's a big deal. And the guy said, "Oh, then why have we been resisting for all these years?" This is a major weakness for the regime in the next period. It realizes it cannot continue the way it has up until now. It needs to open up. In fact, it is rapidly moving from a very Islamic rhetoric from the early days of the revolution to a very nationalist movement. It's a major shift in the narrative of the regime. And yet, none of the democratic demands that the Iranian youth has have been granted. And people are already beginning to get impatient. Now, at the same time, with the opening of the Iranian market, you're going to see an influx of investments. Billions of dollars going to pour into the country. And this is going to strengthen the Iranian working class. The first thing they're going to ask for, pay back our back wages. It's the first thing. It's a very decent, very reasonable demand. But it's a very lump, big lump sum to pay for the Iranian capitalists. And it's gonna cause massive tensions. At the same time, the Iranian bourgeoisie want to promote Iran as a producing, industrial country. And they've already said they want to compete with countries like Bangladesh, with low wages. But the Iranian working class has far higher wages than the Bangladeshi, the Bengali. So what we're gonna see is a fierce, violent contradictions coming to the surface. As the working class will try to regain its lost position, and the ruling class will go on an offensive against the working class. Last year, in a small mining town of Bafr, it's a mine with 5,000 workers. The state privatized the mine, sold it to a friend of a friend. And the workers went on strike. And they mobilized 100,000 people living in the town. And the leader of this strike was the chairman of the Islamic Council of Bafr. The other one was the chairman of the State Union, the Workers' House. And they struck for 45 days, which makes it the longest strike since the revolution. And they won. And the state agreed to give the 28% privatized shares to the workers themselves. That's the future of Iran. And the Iranian working class have extremely revolutionary traditions. In the 79 revolution, without any leadership, in fact with the leadership which was working against them, they took over the whole industry of Iran and ran it under workers' control. Though in the end they were betrayed by the Stalinists, bless them. And this is gonna change the whole dynamic of the Arab Revolution. The whole dynamic of the Middle East. Because nothing is over. You shouldn't look at just the surface, what's in the news today. You have to look at what's the situation beneath the surface. In Egypt, the revolution has ebbed. Yes. You know, the Egyptian masses, they overthrew four governments. Five. And what people don't realize is that the last government they overthrew was the government of Sisi, the president. In February of 2014, before he was elected actually, when he was a caretaker president, there was a mass movement of 200,000 workers which overthrew the Biblawi government, the prime minister. Now, Sisi, when he came to power, he was given power by the revolution. For the sake of the revolution. When I was in Egypt in October, after he'd taken power, he was like a god. People offered themselves to him on TV, literally. There were songs about him. But then you see, then he opened his mouth. He had to say something in the presidential elections. They tried to keep him away from the cameras. He had to say something. But it completely diffused the bubble. I forgot what he said. He made very funny things. And in the end, when he was elected, they said he got 90% of the vote. I'm not even sure about that. But he had to extend voting two times to cover more than 2.5 days. He called a public holiday. He made all transport free. He threatened to fine people if they didn't go voting. And yet only 47% went to vote for him. And since then, he's been attacking living standards, cutting subsidies. But he's not been able to take on the working class head on, which is what he needs if he wants to rule. And the war in Yemen showed that if he tries something, big, there's still a revolutionary ferment below the surface, which will come to the fore again sooner or later. Now, there's so many countries in the Middle East, and they all have the same situation. A crisis of the ruling class, rise of social and class contradictions, a diplomatic crisis, a military crisis, and this whole situation is coming out of. Now, but this is also a lesson to us, comrades. We are Marxists and we are optimists by nature. We believe in the socialist future of the Middle East. But revolution is not. We cannot be sentimental about revolutions. Because the fact is, if you don't take power in a revolution, you're going to have a reactionary situation. And that's where this situation comes from. There's a general depressed mood now in the Middle East. People are looking at Syria, Libya, Egypt. And people are saying, thank God we didn't go that far. Of course, that will all change. But at a price. The people are paying a price now for the mistakes that they made. And they have to learn through their mistakes. But we also at the same time cannot be blinded by, you know, foreign policy, geostrategy. The Americans want this, the British want this, the Iranians want this. It can be very mesmerizing. But what we need to understand is that in those corridors where all these dealings are taking place, the bourgeois are panicking. They have no idea of how to get out of this. They're willing to drag the whole region into barbarism in order to avert themselves losing their positions and their privileges.
von diesen Bildern von ganzen Regionen und dabei einstürzen zu lassen, nur um ihre eigene Position zu retten.
But this will in turn have revolutionary implications in the countries again. Foreign policy and domestic policy is not detached from each other. I think Clausewitz said war is a continuation of politics by other means. That couldn't be clearer than in the Middle East. The crisis of capitalism creates two tendencies. One towards socialism, one towards barbarism. They say that the tradition that Middle Eastern people are prone to Islamism. Islamism. They say Middle Eastern people are prone to Islamism. But the real traditions of the Middle Eastern masses, the real traditions, the political traditions of the masses, are leftists and socialists, left-wing nationalists. And at every single stage, the Islamists were built up by the bourgeois, by the imperialists. And it shows their complete degeneracy and the bankruptcy. That they have to go so much back in time, pre-feudal times, to find people who are willing to wage a battle for them. And revive these barbaric things which should have been extinguished. And that's the real position. That's the real balance of forces. And the same way we see the calm and the ebb, the depression that we see in the Middle East today. Will become its exact opposite within 24 hours as soon as things begin to go. And we have to be ready.